The Atoms.
Hello all, welcome to the session on electron displacement effects and reaction intermediates. This session, we shall hold the key to unlocking the mysteries of organic chemistry. Because when you know how electrons displace or how reaction intermediates form regarding their stability, once these things are clear to you, you are ready to master organic chemistry. So you are ready to learn the other chapters of organic chemistry. I think we can proceed. Organic chemistry, as you know, the chemistry of one particular element called the carbon, the marvelous element that has very unique properties, so it can form millions of compounds, not only with itself but also with certain elements like hydrogen, nitrogen, sulfur, oxygen, phosphorus and other halogens as well. Now see, to learn the nature of organic molecules, to learn why the molecules react, to learn how the molecules can react, you need to know how the electrons in them behave, or how the electrons in them displace, how they get transferred, what are their causative agents, what are their impacts. Those are all that will be covered by inductive effect, the resonance effect, the hyperconjugation and the electromagnetic effect. Then we shall learn about the reaction intermediates, that is the carbocation, carbanion, carbon free radical, only free radicals, nitrines and carbenes. Now, let's proceed to learning the electronic factors or electron displacement effect. The first one, inductive effect. Inductive effect, I can tell you in simple words, it's like tug of war with electrons. It's like two people standing on either side, holding a rope, and that rope, imagine that is all electrons. So the rope can be pulled towards this side or that side depending on the power of the players on either side. And here, that power I call it the electronegativity. So depending on the rope of electrons or to pull along the rope of electrons, depending on these factors, you can call the effect as plus I effect or minus I effect. Stay with me, you'll understand. So first, let me show you two different carbon chains. The chains look similar because both are hydrocarbon chains. Only difference you can see is in their functional group. One is bromine, a halogen. The other one is an amine. So let's see how this attachment of the functional group is going to cause an effect in the carbon chain. Now see, bromine. What's the nature of bromine? It's electronegative, as you predicted. Now, what does electronegativity mean? To have more of an affinity for this particular shared of electrons. You know that every bond has an electron. Every bond has two electrons. So two shared electrons are there. So bromine is electronegative in the sense that it has more ability to pull both electrons towards itself. Now, so the two electrons can be moved closer towards bromine, away from carbon. Now, you know, it doesn't stop with this, okay? It also proceeds to the nearby bonds, like you have another carbon-carbon bond, another carbon-carbon, another carbon-carbon. This effect is proceeding along the chain. It happens along the chain. Only carbon-carbon chain, not carbon-hydrogen chain. So what happens? All of the electrons move towards the side brominous. So you can see more of density over the right side, to the side where the bromine is. This effect is called the minus I effect. Minus I is the pulling of electrons towards this particular functional group due to its electronegative ability. As you can very well predict, this effect is very strong closer to the atom. As you move farther and farther away here, over these bonds, these places, the effect diminishes. It reduces very little. The effect is distance dependent and it is a permanent effect. Why do I say it is permanent? Because this functional group is permanently attached to the chain. Unless it is permanently attached, this effect is going to remain. So because of this effect, what is the change that you can see is this end is going to become slightly electronegative. It is going to develop slightly, say it is electronegative, it is going to develop a slight negative charge, partial negative charge, and so the other part is going to develop a partial positive charge. So you have a little bit of polarity developed in the molecule because of the inductive effect. Now the other case is correctly opposite to this. In what sense? Look at amine, NH2. This group is special in a way that it holds an unpaired electron on it. Nitrogen, being though it is electronegative, you can see it holds a lone pair of electrons. So it has a special nature that it is willing to donate the electron. It is basic, you know, ammonia is basic. Similarly, this is a derivative from ammonia, NH3. So it is willing to donate its electrons. So what happens is here, the electrons move from nitrogen to the ring, to the chain, to the carbon skeleton. It moves in this direction. So the electrons move away from nitrogen towards the chain. So how do I represent this? Electrons are now closer to the carbon, opposite to the previous one. So you remember one effect, the other effect, it you can automatically remember that it's going to be the opposite of this. So this you call it as the plus I effect. So there are lots of examples you will be seeing in the book. General way, you don't have to memorize anything. How you can remember is minus I effect. Any electronegative atom, when you come across, think of minus I effect. It's going to pull the electrons towards itself. For plus I effect, when you see a group that has got a lower pair of electrons, especially this happens with the nitrogen, oxygen, okay, those kinds of functional groups. This happens with electronegative atoms as well as groups that have multiple bonds. For example, you can have cyanide where C triple bond N is there. You can have a carboxylic group where it is COOH, multiple bonds. So wherever you have multiple bonded groups, those groups are going to be electron withdrawing, or that is, they usually have electron negative, right? So they're going to be electron withdrawing. So those groups show minus I effect. So this is about inductive effect. Let's move to the second one. Okay, coming to electromeric effect. Electromeric effect is simply, it's a temporary effect. First, remember that. Then this effect comes into action when there is a reagent. So when you, in earlier case we saw inductive effect, there was only the substrate molecule and the effect was caused by some additional member of the substrate molecule itself. Here when you see electromeric, is not because of the substrate, is because of some additionally entering reagent. Somebody is making an additional entry, that particular compound or that particular reagent is what is going to cause some change in the substrate molecule. Look at the first case. I have alkene, or it is ethylene plus H plus. H plus is what sort of reagent? It's an electrophilic reagent, right? So now what can H plus do to this? See, H plus is positive. So electrophile always wants to get attracted towards, always wants to bind towards a nucleophile. So opposite charges attract each other. So H plus is going to search for a negatively charged partner. So what will it do? It is going to induce a negative charge in this, in my substrate molecule. How? When it comes closer, my molecule, it automatically undergoes some electron displacement in a way that it can attach to this H plus. So how can that be possible? See, this pi electron density can be shifted over to one of the carbon. This is one carbon, this other carbon. Can be shifted to this carbon to get the delta negative charge. This bond weakens now. This bond weakens and this gets a delta positive charge. Now this negative can easily attract or easily attack on the positive electrophile. So this effect I give by the name plus E effect plus electromeric effect. Simply to say, how can I say it is a plus E effect? Just by looking at the attacking reagent, it is an electrophile, so it's a plus E effect. This is an easy way to remember. Then you come to the second case. Cyanide. Cyanide is negative. It's a nucleophile. So here it is an electrophile. I represent it as E plus. And here it is a nucleophile. I represent it as Nu minus. Nucleophile has got a lone pair of electrons. This nucleophile wants an electrophile as a pair. So how it is going to induce some change here? See, this looks for an opportunity to attack. There are two attacking possibilities, because the pi bond is the one that can be easily broken, not the sigma bond. So pi bond, when pi bond breaks, you can have two attacking ends, carbon or oxygen. My cyanide is a negative species. It wants to attack more positive species. Which can be more positive, carbon or oxygen? It is carbon. So my cyanide will attack the carbon. So this bond shifts on to oxygen. So I develop a negative charge. So this gets a positive charge. So this kind of a displacement happens only when there is an attacking reagent, only in the presence of some charged species, nucleophile or electrophile. So I call this a temporary effect. This is called electromeric effect. And because it happens due to a nucleophile, I call this as minus E effect. Okay. So when you see, mostly in electromeric effect, there is attack of the substrate, which is usually a multiple bonded system, by an electrophile or a nucleophile. You call it plus E or minus E. Mostly you don't have questions regarding this, but when you understand this, you will be able to learn better organic chemistry. Let's move to the third effect. Okay, the third effect for you, the resonance or the mesomeric effect. I think you would have heard of resonance several times, but the concept is not well understood by many students. Resonance, when you think of it, you think of benzene ring. No, benzene ring has beautiful hexagonal structure with alternating single and pi bonds. You have three pi bonds, and your teacher says you can interchange that. It's like just tilting the pi bond, the entire ring, so that the bonds get displaced. That is the general image of resonance that comes to our mind. Resonance is even more than that. It's a very, very useful concept that tells us that in organic chemistry, the electron distribution, the way electrons are distributed in organic molecules, is not definite. So you cannot determine, or you cannot fixedly say where the electrons or how the electrons are distributed. And for that, you need at least more than one or two structures. Those structures are called as resonance hybrids or canonical structures. For example, if I take the case of carbonate. Carbonate, you know, the structure is sp2 planar, trigonal planar structure. So, as you can see, I can represent it like this. C double bond O, O minus, O minus. Or I can like keep twisting the molecule. This is one, this is one. So, you can see three different arrangements for carbonate ion. But scientists have proved that experimentally, all of the oxygen atoms are known to carry some amount of charge. Again, another puzzling result they got was all of the carbon-oxygen bonds were known to be of equal length. How? When you see here, one is double bond, the other two is a single bond. So you should have definitely two types of carbon-oxygen bonds, but not so. Practically, all the carbon-oxygen bonds are same, and moreover, the charge, the 2 minus charge, is distributed equally. So how do you account for this? That is why scientists came up with the idea that resonance is, well, you can say, the electrons are delocalized. They are moving. They are not static. They are dynamic in nature. That is, this electron, see, this electron moves here, but this electron moves over here. So you get the next structure. So you get the, this structure. So you can keep moving electrons. Say, so I move this electron, I move this to here, and I move this to here. So similarly, I move this to here, and I move this to here. So I keep getting different structures just by moving the electrons. So that kind of movement is what I call resonance. I move this to here. So similarly, I move this to here, and I move this to here. So I keep getting different structures just by moving the electrons. So that kind of movement is what I call resonance. I'll show you another example of resonance in larger molecule. So this is an example of resonance in non-conjugated system. When I say non-conjugated, it is absence of alternate double and single bonds. Here you can see there is one double bond, one single bond. It stops with that. When I say conjugated system, it means a benzene kind of a system. Say I should have one pi, one double bond, single bond, double bond, single bond, double bond, single bond. So there should be some alternate single pi, single double, single double. Even this is also a conjugated system. Look at this. It's a straight chain. This is a cyclic conjugated system. Straight chain conjugated system. Double bond, single bond, double bond, single bond, double bond, single bond, double bond. Okay? So these kinds of structures also can draw resonance. How do I draw? Just by displacing the pi electrons. See, this the pair of electrons goes over here, and from and consequently this carbon valency will change. So this electrons cannot stay here. They have to come over here. Similarly, this has to come over here. This is what you call resonance. The movement or the constant delocalization of electrons. For this, what I do? These two electrons come over here, these two shift over here, this shifts over here, and this can shift on this atom. Okay? So this is how I ensure resonance in my conjugated and non-conjugated systems. And there is a simple rule. That is, if you are thorough with these three ways in which the electron displacements can happen, you are pretty sure to how to draw the resonance structures for different molecules. Let us see that. The three ways in which you can draw the electron displacements correctly in resonance. This is meant for resonance. So first you can see, when I have a pi bond, the pi electrons, you know, they are loose. They are ready to react. They are reactive. So the pi electrons, the two electrons in the pi bond, can shift to the adjacent atom, just as we saw in electromeric effect. So what happens if it's going to shift this side, and this particular atom gets a negative charge, because both electrons go over to this atom, or it can shift to the left hand side atom. So in that case, this will get a negative charge. So remember, if one atom gets negative charge, the other should get a positive charge, because this is getting both of the electrons. This is not getting the electron, it is losing the electron. So positive charge. So pi bond to atom is one type. Then you see atom. This atom, the atom in this corner, in this vertex, has got a pair of electrons. This can give electrons to this bond and make it a pi bond like this. So that this is transfer of electrons from the lone pair of electrons from atom to the bond, atom to pi bond. See, atom to pi bond. It's the reverse of this. Both are the reverse of each other. Now then you see, this is just pi bond shifting to another pi bond. See, this can shift over here so that I get this kind of a structure. So that this atom, the end atom, gets a positive charge. Okay. So this is an example, or this is a resonance you find in vinyl. This is a vinyl system, right? It's a vinyl system, vinyl cation. So these are the ways in which you can move the electrons in resonance. So here you have plus R effect and minus R effect. And I forgot to say, resonance is also called mesomeric effect. So you can say even plus M or minus M effect. Again, close is similar to inductive effect. The groups, usually all of the groups that show plus I effect, plus inductive effect, show plus R effect here. And all of the groups that show minus I effect show minus R effect, with one exception. I'll just note or give some details on the exception alone. The exception is the halogens. Halogens show minus I effect in inductive, because the electronegative, they're going to pull the electron towards itself, so they're going to show minus I effect. Whereas when it comes to resonance, they are going to show plus I effect. Sorry, plus R effect. Resonance, it shows plus resonance effect, halogens. The reason is, halogens, if you see, this is general representation of halogens, X. And you know, halogens are going to have this effect, halogens. The reason is, so now you see, halogen has got a lone pair of electrons. These lone pair of electrons are used up in the plus R effect. Now, I'll quickly show you how plus R effect and plus minus R effect operate in benzene rings. Okay? We should quickly see how to write the canonical forms of the resonating structures for the plus R and the minus R effect. For plus R, I have chosen a group that shows plus R. So, I told you, halogen is an exception. It shows plus R effect and minus I effect. All others shows plus I. If it shows plus I, it's going to show plus R. If it shows minus I, it's going to show minus R. But halogen is an exception showing plus R and minus I effect. So we'll see how halogen shows plus R. Halogen has got lone pair of electrons on it. So these lone pairs can be given to the benzene ring. So when it comes to resonance alone, they are turning as electron donors rather than electron acceptors. They're not going to withdraw electrons. They are going to donate the electron pair. How? This way. See, these two electrons are donated to the adjacent bond. We saw three ways in which it can the resonance can happen, right? Three ways in which electron transfer. The same I'm going to apply it here. It transfers here. So I write the first structure. I'm going to write it small. So here, X gets a plus charge. I'm not going to mention the lone pair for sake of time. The other bonds are intact. Now you see, this, if I'm going to bring double bond over here, you can see this bond cannot stay here, right? Because it disturbs with the valency of carbon. Valency of carbon is always 4, not 5. So what happens immediately, there is this bond shifts to the next adjacent atom. So what happens? This atom gets a negative charge. This gets a negative charge. This that is ortho position to the halogen gets a negative charge and the other bonds remain intact. This is the first structure. The second structure, what happens? This negative charge has to be presented, transferred to the next step. So what happens is that this from the charge from this atom will be transferred to the next bond that is here. Now if this will transfer here, this will transfer to the atom. So I write the next structure. How it goes? It goes here and this goes to the atom. This remains intact. Now the second one, this charge, again I start from the charge to the bond and bond to the atom. Almost we are going to complete almost. And now you see, it goes here, it goes to the atom. The other ones are just like that. Now the negative charge goes over here and this double bond finally goes over back to this position to get the, again when you write the next step, it's going to be the first step. So I can write some 4 or 5 canonical structures or resonating structures for the plus R effect. Similarly, we write it for the minus R effect. Here, it is the minus R is pulling of electrons away, just like inductive, pulling of electrons away from here. My chain is, it's a ring here, because it resonance, I talk about a ring, a conjugated system. So pulling electrons away from the ring. So you see, this, it starts from the electronegative element. Oxygen is electronegative, it pulls this pair of pi electrons towards itself like this. If this is getting pulled, now what is going to happen? This bond is going to get pulled towards here. Okay? So this starts with the first step. So here I have a double bond and it's O minus over here. It's again O over here. And here, since this bond has moved away, this end carbon is going to get a positive charge, right? This gets a positive charge because away. See, when the electrons move on the particular atom, you give a negative charge. If it moves away, you get a positive charge. Now, the other bonds intact. Now, what happens? Consecutively, every other bond gets pulled towards that this particular direction. Now, this bond has to be moved. Now, it's from bond. Always remember, electron only initiates the moment, not the positive charge. You cannot draw arrows from the positive charge. So, this electron to this bond. Okay. So, what happens? This bond goes over here. So now this bond becomes empty, so it gets a positive charge. The other ones are just like that. Now, this place is now pulling electrons. So this O comes over here. And now finally, this electron, this bond come over here. I'm sorry, I have to give a positive charge here. And then this comes over back here. And then we get the first step. Okay? So this is it. This is about the resonance effect that you see. Plus R and in plus, minus R systems. So just remember, one thing you have to notice is, in plus R compounds, in compounds or in substituents that show plus R effect, you can see negative charge in ortho and para position. See ortho position, para position. So, negative charge in ortho and para position means they are susceptible to electrophilic attack in the ortho and para positions. Here you can see positive charge in ortho and para positions. So, that means what? Positive charge in all the ortho and para positions means negative charge in the other positions. It indirectly means so. That is why nitro is a meta-directing group. See, meta positions are negative. So it draws the electrophile. Mostly when we study of benzene systems, we study of electrophilic substitution reactions. So with respect to electrophilic substitution reactions, it is ortho and para-directing in the case of plus R groups and meta-directing in the place of minus R groups. Okay, I think it's clear. The last important topic is hyperconjugation. Hyperconjugation is something similar to resonance effect. So you can learn both of them almost together. Only that the difference is, in resonance you see the pi bonds moving, the pi bonds starting the delocalization. But here you have the sigma bonds. It is also called the no bond resonance. Hyperconjugation is actually a very helpful effect. It helps stabilize carbocation and alkene. Okay, let us see how it does that. See, if I have a carbocation here, the carbocation is attached to another carbon that has three other hydrogens attached to. So I call this carbon as the alpha carbon, and the carbons the hydrogens attached to the alpha carbon as alpha hydrogens. So there are three alpha hydrogens. Let me note this point. Now see, this is, as I told you, it is sigma electron donation to the carbocation. You know, carbocation is positively charged. Any charge which is going to be unstable, so as your carbocation as well. Now, to give it more stability, you need someone who can give it electrons. So that is your sigma bond. So it's your sigma electrons. So what can your sigma bond do? This sigma bond, carbon hydrogen sigma bond, is going to donate its electron by means of orbital overlap. That is not needed for us because it's little complicated. Or if you want, I can show you. Okay, here. This is a carbocation with one empty p orbital, and your this carbon hydrogen bond has got a sigma bond, sigma orbital. Okay, that particular sigma orbital and this p empty p orbital will overlap. That is nothing but the two electrons electron density is shared with the carbocation to make it more stable. So when it is shared, you can rub off the bond between this particular carbon and hydrogen and show that this, now because of this sharing of sigma bond to the carbocation or with the carbocation is going to become more stable because it's getting some negative charge, negative and positive will neutralize itself and it's going to become more stable. So stability of carbocation is because of hyperconjugation. Hyperconjugation is donation of sigma electrons or delocalization of sigma electrons for the sake of stability of a carbocation or an alkene. Okay, so here you can draw resonance structures. Like, see, I have drawn one resonance structure with this particular carbon hydrogen sigma bond donation here. Similarly, you can draw with another resonance structure where you can show this bond being erased, that is this bond going to this particular carbocation. So similarly, how many number of alpha hydrogens did we see? We saw three alpha hydrogens. So there are going to be three conjugative structures or three resonance structures, three hyperconjugative structures for this particular structure, this particular molecule. So I will say that this carbocation is stabilized by three resonance structures or three hyperconjugative structures. So I think you would have got the point. The greater the number of alpha hydrogens, the greater will be the stability of the carbocation. Okay, so greater the number of alpha hydrogens, greater will be the hyperconjugative structures, so greater will be the stability of the carbocation. That we will see in the reaction intermediates video. Now see another system with an alkene attached. So again, this alkene, the next, very next atom to an alkene is this carbon. This carbon I call this alpha carbon. So this hydrogens are again going to be alpha hydrogens. Okay, so again three alpha hydrogens, the same case as above, three alpha hydrogens. Now how can this help? Again, this is going to help by giving its electrons. How? See, this gives its electrons to this and this gives its electrons to this. There's a kind of resonance happening. So because of that, suppose, okay, so this particular carbon hydrogen sigma bond is being donated. So here I rub off the bond. Okay, so you see now my, so this, so there is one kind of resonance happening. Similarly, I can give as many of number of resonance structures as there are alpha hydrogens. Three alpha hydrogens, I can give three resonance structures. So greater, you know, greater the number of resonance structures, greater will be the stability, right? So this is going to be stable. Now there's a question, like there are a carbocation or an alkene with five alpha hydrogens, one with three alpha hydrogens, which is more stable? You normally know the greater the number of alpha hydrogens, the more is the stability for both the carbocation as well as the alkene. Here in alkene, in addition to imparting stability to the alkene, this particular hyperconjugative effect also gives it some nucleophilic character. See, it is giving it some negative charge. It is becoming more nucleophilic because of this hyperconjugative effect. That is, the alkene attached to the alpha carbon that holds some alpha hydrogens is going to be more nucleophilic than an alkene that has no alpha carbon. See, suppose there is another alkene. This alkene has an alpha carbon. Another alkene, there is no alpha carbon. All are hydrogens. If you are going to compare both the cases, this alkene is more stable and more nucleophilic because of the hyperconjugative effect. This is less nucleophilic. Okay, so that is it. Since this has taken so much of time, we shall learn about reaction intermediates in the next video.